welcome to week three of MECO6936 Social Media Communication. This week we've got a pre-recorded lecture for you. Dr. Madeline Borthwick from the Design School has come over to talk about designing social media, particularly within cultural institutions. So she will give the lecture, and of course if you have questions after viewing the video, you can email them to me or Madeline directly, and or of course on social media as well, and we can ensure that you get a video back. So please, Madeline, thank you.
So welcome everybody to today's lecture. I'm Madeline Borthwick, and I'll be talking to you about digital disruption and social media, particularly with reference to the cultural sector. First, a few words about me, so you understand where I'm coming from. I'm an associate lecturer here at Sydney University. I teach design computing. And when I'm not working at the university, I have my own consultancy in which I develop interactive multimedia for museums. So things like games, kiosks, interactive projections, basically anything that's educational and interactive in a museum. So in this line of work, I've had experience over the past 8 years in working with different cultural institutions, and especially with museums, which is why a lot of my case studies today will be with reference to museums. So before I start talking about social media in this area, I'd first like to take a step back and look at the broader technological developments of the last decade or so. Because during this last decade, our behaviour has changed in some really fundamental ways. And there's been two key catalysts in these changes. One has been the rise of portable computing, and the other has been the influence that social media has had on our way of interacting with one another. And so the way that we access information and consume media has changed dramatically because of these two things. And for the cultural sector, who are a major producer of content in the form of music, theatre, film, and other cultural activities, this has of course had many roll-on effects. So although this lecture will mostly be about museums, I'd actually just like to start with an example from the music industry. And this is because the music industry was one of the first cultural industries to be deeply affected by these changes. Now, some of you may recognise this interface. This is a program called Napster, which created a huge amount of controversy during the 90s. Now, Napster was the first piece of technology that allowed people to simply download MP3 files. It had a powerful search engine that allowed you to locate them. You could also stop and start downloads whenever you wanted. You didn't have to download the whole piece of music in one session, which, considering the slow bandwidth and network speeds of the 90s, was a very important thing. And most importantly, it introduced the concept of peer-to-peer sharing, which actually meant there was not a single legal entity that was responsible for breach of copyright. And it took some years before the music industry, particularly in the form of Metallica, managed to successfully prosecute Napster and get them to pay some damages for this huge amount of illegal music that had been transacted between users of the program. But the horse had already bolted. Music had become digital and infinitely replicable. And with the network, with the sort of the internet available as a technical means of transferring that infinitely replicable data, it was no longer limited. There was no CD, no tape, no record that was actually putting an end to that. But the mass acceptance of Napster wasn't just because it was free. It actually also tapped into a number of needs that weren't being met. And where Napster left off, other more legal music providers took up the reins. So most of you know iTunes. iTunes was one of the first to kind of jump on this bandwagon and provide a music service in which you could actually just purchase a single track without purchasing the whole album. Something that seems quite mundane now, but was actually revolutionary at the time. And now we see it's going further and further. Music has turned into a service with platforms such as Spotify that actually make it available as a kind of subscription. So you're no longer paying for music as a physical good, you're paying for the rights to access it. And this has really changed the way we consume music as well. The concept of albums has become almost irrelevant, and the music taste of young people is said to be broader than ever, because you no longer have kind of limited cash to purchase just one or two CDs of your favourite bands. And at some point, social media functions also started to become intertwined with these platforms. And the social media functions of Spotify mean that we can now more easily find our peers and share our music tastes in a very low barrier way. And all in all, this has had mixed results for the music industry. So they have less protection via copyright and make less money out of sales. But there's more publicity available for bands that are starting out and more ability for them to be easily discovered. So a lot of music musicians and music providers have actually taken to touring more rather than relying on the money from sales. So music may have been one of the first cultural institutions and industries to be digitally disrupted, but others have followed hard on its heels. And the next one I'd like to talk about is museums. So this graph is from a study that was carried out in 2014 into the Australian GLAM sector, GLAM standing for Galleries, Libraries, Archives and Museums, in which they identified one of their biggest problems, in fact their biggest problem, was engaging new audiences and staying relevant. And slightly less critical but also very important was the issue of digitising collections. And the reason that these two things are so crucial to them at the moment is because they're actually in the midst of a digital disruption and they're busy reinventing themselves as we speak. So museums have traditionally seen themselves as a kind of gatekeepers of knowledge. But with the rise of the internet, information became freely available and, well, everywhere really. And now you can access content from your own couch. You don't need to go to a library or a museum in order to find out more about certain topics. And even artworks have become digital. And with projects like Google Art, you can view the inside of a museum and a specific artwork in high res from anywhere in the world. So for an industry that has traditionally defined itself as being an authority on cultural matters and a keeper of collections, this can be quite difficult to adapt to. Meanwhile, it's also becoming harder and harder to hold people's attention and keep them engaged when everyone basically has a supercomputer in their pocket. So more and more museums are realising that they have to embrace digital technologies if they're to survive in this new world. And what I've seen happening over the last 8 years particularly is a move away from the showstopper exhibits that would utilise new technology sometimes in a gimmicky kind of way to bring people into the museum, and a move towards a more subtle approach where digital technologies are integrated as an extra layer of the museum experience. So rather than digital being the cherry on top, it's become much more woven through the fabric of the museum. And I think it says a lot that if we look at these excerpts of the digital strategy of three major world museums, the Tate Britain, MoMA and the Science Museum, we see the Tate, for example, saying that digital will need to become a dimension of everything the Tate does, a sentiment which is eerily echoed by the Science Museum, who says that our mission is dependent on making digital a dimension of everything the group does. MoMA goes one step further, acknowledging how digital strategy can actually be used to prolong the lifetime of an exhibition. So actually indicating that it's not just something they have to do, but actually a potential improvement to what they're already doing. All these are signs that disruption is leading to a big shift in the way that these cultural institutions think. And we've seen how music and museums have been disrupted by these changes. But similar things have also happened with film and photography, which I won't be going into so much today. For a long time, it seemed like physical objects were safe because they consist of physical matter that can't be sent digitally, just like the CDs and the records of the past. But even this is no longer the case. We have now transcended the physical barrier. With the birth of 3D scanning and printing technologies and the increasing accessibility of these technologies, we can now easily reproduce three-dimensional objects in a digital fashion. Services like Shapeways allow people to create and share physical objects through their online platform using a printing and mailing service. And before long, this technology will be in every household. It's already in some of them, but the price barrier is dropping and the usefulness of it is very apparent. And the same applies for fashion, now that we have technologies like 3D knitting hitting the scene. So this is a Nike shoe that's entirely knitted by machine, meaning that this design can be created digitally, sent to the knitting machine and reproduced at another site. So soon maybe we'll be seeing designer goods being released illegally for people to download them on the Napster of the future. This is a cultural industry that's next for disruption. So where does social media come into all of this? Well, against this background of disruption, cultural institutions are becoming more and more digital ready and more willing to embrace new means of public engagement. And one of the tools that they're learning to leverage more and more is social media. So historically, museums in particular haven't been the most democratic institutions. They tend to cater for quite a small segment of the public that consider themselves to be publicly culturally interested. And you'll notice that there's this kind of gap in the visitation of museums. So people go on a school excursion when they're young, then there's this kind of dead zone in between, and then they come back when they're retired. And this is something that's actually really a big problem for museums and a threat to them if they want to survive. So they're looking for ways to better serve the communities that they're part of and be more inclusive. This is an image from a wonderful book called The Participatory Museum by Nina Simon, which focuses very much on this topic of museums and their changing structures. So in the traditional notion of a cultural institution, that institution uses the weight of their authority to provide expertise and content to the audiences that are visiting them in a manner that this public can digest. In a participatory museum, which is a new model that she says we should be and in some cases are moving towards, the visitors actually provide the content and the discourse, and the institution itself just provides a scaffolding and a platform for their cultural dialogue and the content that they generate. So in this new model of a cultural institution, as in the social web, user-generated content suddenly moves front and center. Visitors are encouraged to contribute meaningfully to the collections of the museums, and the museums provide them with the tools and the means to do so. In these three examples, we can see higher quality user-generated content from several museums around the world. So here on the left, we have a wallpaper exhibit from the Cooper Hewitt Museum in New York. It takes place in the Cooper Hewitt Museum is an art and design museum. And in this particular exhibit, they're talking about wallpaper design, and the visitors can actually make their own wallpaper and then see it projected in a room to see how it would look. And some of the contributions that come out of these are amazing. I mean, this is quite a nice one already, but pop online and have a look if you want to see more of them. Here we have a pledge board exhibit, which is from the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, from an exhibit called Memory, From Memory to Action, which is about how people can be motivated to act against racism and genocide. And in this exhibit, people actually write down their own pledge on a piece of paper, and they put it through a letterbox which digitally scans it and puts it up on the wall as part of this exhibition. So when you come in here as a visitor, you're overwhelmed by the message of all these other visitors who've been before you, and feel more motivated to take part yourself and actually do something about, you know, the exhibitions that you've seen during that day. The last example is from a project called It's Time We Met from the Metropolitan Museum of Art, where the museum asked visitors to submit their photos from the gallery using Flickr. And in that case, they also got very many high quality contributions, of which this one was my favourite. So the notion of user-generated content in museums is starting to gain a lot of traction and draws directly on some of the fundamental principles of social media. There's a case study I'd like to show you about this in particular, which is a project called Reich Studio. Reich Studio is a project from the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam, which, if you don't know it, is where many of the famous paintings by the Dutch masters are hanging. And a number of years ago, they made the bold move to digitise their entire collection, making all the works publicly available at high resolution. So Reich Studio is a custom created website. It's not an existing social media platform, it's one that they specifically made, that allows visitors to make these collections and share them with the community that moves on Reich Studio. They can use the museum app to save works during their visit. So if they see something in real life that they think is really fantastic, they basically click a little heart icon and that gets sent directly to their Reich Studio. And they can also use the web-based platform to arrange their collections and to browse the museum's entire digital collection in order to sort of make snapshots and themes and basically build up a collection that they think is interesting. And critically, they can also order reproductions and printed objects using their collected works or download them and print them out themselves. And the most important thing, I think, about Reich Studio is actually that the visitors can repurpose the artworks in any way they want. The museum has put the content completely in their hands. And in order to encourage the creativity that this inspires, they actually have a yearly competition in which they ask people to design products and come up with ideas for how their collection could be used to make fantastic things. So you here, for example, you see a pack of cards that's taken all kinds of animals from the collection that person has actually sought out one by one in order to create this object. I think the key to Reich Studio's success is this kind of creativity that it enables, that has led to it being quite a well-used platform. What's also unusual about it is that it's a successful example of a custom-created social media platform, whereas many museums actually choose the strategy of piggybacking on existing social media platforms by making use of viral marketing. Now, viral marketing is particularly suitable to the cultural sector for a number of reasons. Firstly, if a museum has a well-designed content-generating experience, it can automatically lend itself to viral marketing, and I'll show you a few examples in a minute. So basically they can kill two birds with one stone. They do something that's really fun to do in the museum, people post it online and they get free publicity out of it. Secondly, social media functionalities can easily be integrated into museum exhibits. Most big social media platforms have an API, an application programming interface, which means it's easy to kind of hook some custom software into that social media platform so that you can... Wow. So you can, for example, create something and then post it directly to Facebook while you're in the museum. This is a very important one. Low to no cost. So cultural institutions tend not to be the most well-funded institutions, and viral marketing is free. So this is a really important consideration for them. And I think what's also interesting about viral marketing is it can bring across experiential qualities of a cultural experience that are hard to communicate in other ways. So in particular, short videos or online clips can help to materialise sort of intangible acoustic or visual factors and actually allow visitors to have a kind of a preview of the sort of experience they'll have if they go into the museum. And this can help support their decision to actually go and visit the museum for real. So I've got a couple of examples of what kinds of things might lead to successful viral marketing from a couple of projects I've worked on myself. This is Wondercomes. It's an art museum in the Netherlands, and they have quite a large fashion collection. And one of the rooms in this space actually allows visitors to try on replica dresses from the collection. And of course, they get a photo moment. They get to take a photo of themselves wearing these amazing dresses. And that's extremely shareable. It's got sort of personal elements of the visitor in there. It's something they definitely couldn't do at home. And it's something that provides a really nice memento of their experience to the museum. This one I particularly like. It's from the Heineken experience. And it's a blue screen, or actually green screen, I should say, exhibit where the visitors get on a bike, they start pedaling, and as they pedal, Amsterdam moves by in the background. And while they're doing that, they're singing a Dutch karaoke song, which is hilarious since most of the people to the Heineken experience don't speak Dutch. This little clip, along with a couple of other exhibits like this in the Heineken experience, gets shared 50,000 times a month. So, you know, imagine how easy it is for them to get new visitors on the base of sharing these kinds of things. And sometimes it can go as far so that these kinds of digital souvenirs become the backbone of the experience. This is a project called the Institute of Sound and Vision, again in the Netherlands, in which the museum wanted to encourage people to play with content from the archive. So their collection is not very tangible. It's clips from movies, images, and basically all the television media that's been produced in the Netherlands for a very long time. So visitors to this museum actually create a small profile when they arrive. They get given an RFID ring that allows them to log in to every single exhibit. And they can create their own digital souvenirs along the way. So for example, this is an exhibit called The Show Door, where they kind of burst through a door and they get filmed from all angles with a cheesy theme music playing. But there's also exhibits where they can splice themselves into a chase scene, where they can sing along with their favourite cabaret star. So actually, these kinds of viral marketing elements become the whole experience. The next thing I'd really like to talk to you about today is crowdsourcing in the context of the cultural sector. And I've got a number of case studies that have this one thing in common. In that they leverage crowdsourcing in order to produce something of cultural or functional value. Some of you might know this. It's an app called SoundHound. It's kind of similar to Shazam, so it identifies music that's playing around you. And what's really interesting about SoundHound is that it can also identify songs that you're singing or humming. And if you think about that for a minute, that's really difficult. Everybody has different voices. Not everyone can sing on key. So how on earth have they done that? So the way they've actually allowed this to happen is quite ingenious and relies entirely on crowdsourced performances in order to train the identification software. So SoundHound is actually linked to a separate social media platform called Midomi, which kind of serves as its back end. So on Midomi, people actually sing karaoke performances of their favourite songs, sometimes very many. I think the highest contributor had sung 946 different songs. And by having this kind of separate social media platform feeding into SoundHound, it allows them to build up a database of how different voices sound when singing the same song. This notion of crowdsourcing is not only used for practical functions, though. It can be quite practical in that it delegates a lot of the heavy lifting to your users, but it can also be used very innovatively. And one of my favourite examples is this project called Life in a Day. So Life in a Day was a project where Ridley Scott used YouTube as a vehicle to collect user-generated content from July the 24th, 2010, and produced a video that provides a kind of a time capsule snapshot of what people thought was important on that day. And the result is this beautiful and moving snapshot of human experience. And I'd like to quickly play you the trailer, if the computer will allow me to. As you can see, this is extremely high quality content that's led to a high quality cultural production. Some museums have been able to leverage crowdsourcing for the more functional purposes they have, and one that's done this very well is archives. This particular archive is the Hastings Pier, and they have something they call the digital memory, which is a library of images of people using the pier and enjoying the pier that's been built up over a very long period of time. And this archive is not static. It continues to be built upon to this day because the pier is still open and still in use. And people can contribute to it by adding their photos. So they're actually adding to the collection of the museum as they go along. It's a living archive. And the other thing that they can do is identify and tag photos. So if they happen upon a photo of someone that they know, maybe their great-grandmother or something that they can contribute information about, they're actually able to add to the curatorial information about those pictures. So by doing this, they're performing tasks that were traditionally reserved for the institution to do, not for members of the public, and actively contributing to the body of knowledge in the museum. So my last topic for today is the topic of identity and experientialism, which in this case is actually mostly about selfies. So there's been a lot of discussion about the phenomenon of selfies in the cultural sector. But first, a few words about the selfie itself, and why everybody is taking them. There's a lot of ideas around this. This is one I find particularly interesting. And it's all got to do with keeping up with the Joneses. So previously, people would compete with material objects, you know, a bigger car, a fancier dress. We've sort of got this urge to compete, and this was the way that people would do it in the past, which led to this phrase of keeping up with the Joneses next door. But the currency of competition has changed in the last years from material possessions to unique experiences. Which is why when you log into Facebook, you're bound to see a photo of someone's latest trip or this amazing meal they had at this amazing restaurant. So we're actually having this interesting move from materialism to experientialism. And a selfie is something that's quite typical of this because it records you having an experience. And on one hand, this has some negative side effects because we end up comparing ourselves to a very large group of people and maybe feeling like we're missing out. But on the other hand, it also has an overwhelmingly positive side effect, which is that a lot of research suggests that experiences make us happier than things. Experiences are less easy to get bored of than material possessions. They often have an element of anticipation, which leads to this kind of delayed gratification when you actually have the experience. And critically, they're often social in nature and bring us closer to other people. This photo in particular has triggered an enormous amount of debate about the appropriateness of selfies to record cultural experiences and whether it's always suitable to take photos at a cultural site. So many people thought that, you know, her happy face was inappropriate for the gravity of the site that she was visiting. I like to put it in context a little bit because this girl got a lot of criticism for this photo. And her explanation was that she had actually planned a trip with her father. He died earlier that year and they were going to visit this site together. So her recording of this moment was a way of saying, look, Dad, I made it. So basically her reply to the criticism was, well, sorry, but I'm not sorry. And there's other artists actually who've been sort of exploring this same notion of when is a selfie appropriate. This is a Jewish artist called Shahak Shapira, who took photos that were taken at the Berlin War Memorial, which is a memorial to the Holocaust, and actually changed the backgrounds to show actual Holocaust photos, just to make these people think about whether the actions they were taking were appropriate. Now, there's some aspects of this whole debate around selfies that have the dimensions of a moral panic. So the media tends to focus on extreme examples of, you know, where people have kind of fallen off a cliff while taking a selfie or, you know, beheaded someone with their selfie stick. And you often see this kind of moral panic whenever a new technology raises its head. So some of you might recall the same kind of conversations about violent video games and whether these are affecting people. But actually there's kind of this rising body of evidence that puts identity at the centre of this visitor experience. So many museums are afraid that their artworks are becoming backdrops for selfies. This particular slide, which is part of the work of Ali Burness, who is co-author of a book about museums and visitor photography, actually studied a sample of visitor selfies. And discovered that only a very small part of it was this kind of self-love category where visitors are just, you know, taking a photo of themselves to look good. And actually, most of them were sort of a bit more critical in nature. And they were about evaluating the museum, about recording social and personal moments. Sometimes they were a creative response to the artworks. And actually, in terms of their nature, they were showing a deeper engagement with the museum and its objects. And since these kind of discoveries, some museums have jumped on the bandwagon. There's one that's even got a tour that's curated around the selfies that are taken at the museum. So they look and see which objects come up the most often, and that's kind of the selfie tour that you can take to look at the visitors' favourite objects. So that brings me more or less to a close for today, but I hope that I've made it clear to you that social media is a really powerful tool to enrich the cultural sector, and particularly through the means of the topics that I've covered in these slides. So by enabling cultural contributions via user-generated content, leveraging viral marketing to increase promotion and awareness of cultural institutions, utilising crowdsourcing to share curatorial tasks and do some of the heavy lifting, and also in the process of doing so, actually increasing public engagement. And finally, by enabling visitor expressions of identity, regardless of their format. Thanks very much, and have a good day.